Good day and good evening. Thank you for each and every one of you for being here with us today. I am Joanna Poon, Head of Discipline, Built Environment at the University of Derby. Today marks the CIOB's very first Global Academic Summit, and I am delighted to be able to welcome you all today. Before we get started today, I would like to express my sincere appreciation to all of you who make time to attend the CIOB Academic Summit 2023. Today wouldn't have been possible without you. The CIOB Academic Summit is a unique conference dedicated to our global academic community. The summit is aimed at leading the way to transform our academics connectivity on a global scale, leading the way for cross collaborations, sharing of cutting edge research, knowledge and education, and most importantly, building of a strong sense of community. Well, I do not want to take too much of your time. I need to leave some time for our guests, contributors, and I'm certain today will be fun and full of learning. So a very warm welcome to each one of you. Welcome back to those who also joined us in the morning session. If you have any questions, suggestions, clarifications, or just want to say hi, please do so on our chat box. I would now like to please call upon Antonio Nadirio, who will be facilitating our first PM presentations. Over to you, Antonia.
Thank you, Joanna, and I hope you can see me all or hear me all.
Can do, yes, excellent. Thank
you. So good day to you all. For those of you who were with us from the beginning of the summit and this morning, I hope you enjoyed the event so far. It is my pleasure to introduce our first guest speaker of the afternoon session of CIOB Academic Summit, Tony Or, who graduated from City University of Hong Kong with a Bachelor of Science in Surveying in July 2020 and is employed as an Assistant Quantity Surveyor by Beria Consultants Limited, and also as a part-time research assistant. He is a Silver Award winner in Grand Challenge Scholar Programme of National Academy of Engineering. He is also 2021 CIOB Construction Innovation Scholarship winner. So Tony inspired the entire panel of judges with his research proposal of building dwellings with bamboo for elderly residents, which resonates with our CIOB policy positions and on sustainability, affordability, climate change, and equality or the quality of life. So I will now stop talking so that you can hear from Tony himself. The presentation will take roughly 45 minutes, which will be followed by a short 10 minutes Q&A session. So have your questions ready to put in the chat box and enjoy it, and see you all shortly. So welcome, Tony.
Hello. Can everybody hear my voice? Hello.
We can hear you,
yes. Good afternoon. Good afternoon, Joanna. And good afternoon, Antonia.
Good afternoon.
Hello, nice to meet you. And also, I would like to say good afternoon to all the audience. Very welcome to this CIOB Academic Summit 2023. Yeah, and I'm feeling very honorable to be one of the guest speakers today. Hi, Antonia. Isn't it my presentation shall begin now?
Yes, of course. Would you like to share yours, or would you like me to share a screen with your presentation?
Is it okay to have your help, please?
Yes, I will.
Before talking about the presentation, actually, we will also produce two of our very precious video to you during this presentation, and they serve as the gift to all the audience, and hope you all can enjoy. Thank you.
Thank you.
And right now, yes, I guess, I guess I shall begin my presentation. Yeah. May I start now?
Yes. Thank you.
Hi everyone, I'm Tony, and this is the content page today. And I will firstly introduce myself, my project team, the research method, and also in part two, you can find more about the details, the deliverables of this project. Thank you. Next page, please. Yeah. And this is a short summary of myself. I graduated in 2020 in CTU, and I'm working in the consultant firm as the assistant surveyor. And actually, I would say that it is this very precious scholarship to help me my dream to come true, to bring the green and sustainable construction, like the bamboo construction, to real world. And yeah, next me. And actually, I will also say a quick thanks to my project teammate. Actually, we have four of us, including me, Meng, the graduate structural engineer, and also Crystal and David. They are both the building service engineering graduate. While myself mainly focus on the building design and the costing. And also, I also look at the green building. And yeah, I will also need to mention my supervisors, Professor Lim and Dr. Fong. Yeah, thank you both then. And then I would like to firstly talk about the background of this project. Yeah, I would say that our project starts by the two technical problems, which many of us find very hard to deal with, the aging population. And also another one is the very huge housing price. And let's talk about the first one. I believe most of the modern cities are facing the similar problems. The growing population, and according to the WHO World Health Organization, it shall have nearly 2 billion growing population in 2050. And till now, Hong Kong has about 16 out of 100 people, they are the elderly. And the elderly care facilities are highly insufficient. And I would say that this problem becomes even worse. And in 2018, it met 1 to 8 in ratio. And then another issue is the housing problem. We can see, Antonio, yeah, the housing issue, yeah. The figures, you can see, they are actually the rental, which is quite scary, isn't it? In Hong Kong, it has the highest rental and also the probably the transaction fees, you can see. While Singapore and Japan is nearly half of it, and they are mainly due to the three problems. Land shortage. Land shortage is a very complicated problem. And I would say it's highly linked to the link free development and the development and building approval. There are also some very complex situation to deal with the brownfield. Maybe some hidden transaction or an occupation by the landlords. And another issue, when we talk about the construction cost, it becomes more severe during the pandemic issues. And we can see there's a poor labor wage in the construction sector, as well as the inflation. And the living density is also quite hard to imagine, especially in Hong Kong, you know, because Hong Kong, it is so little, but many buildings are built on the slopes, the hills. and the developers try their very best to earn the money by building bundles of the big housing estates, the building blocks, the tall skyscrapers. Yeah. And then we shall talk about the solution. Yeah. And then firstly, I will come up with the bamboo as a structural material. And I need to stress that we shall focus on the laminated one, not the stranded bamboo, because we also need to look at the suitability of the structural performance, the integrity. Yeah. And also the use to different parts of the building, not just the structure, but also maybe the finishing, the roof, or even the claddings, facade. And yeah, another main point to mention is we try not to use concrete and cement to help the earth, try to eliminate the very poor greenhouse gas pollution, and also try to not to use rebar and formers. And the final point is the modular integrated construction. You may wonder what is it? Actually, this term refers to the prefabrication. It means to have the whole building flat or the units. To firstly, it is tailor-made in the factory, and then using the logistic delivery truss to move them on site, and then has the joiner to make it, yeah, to fix it on the site. And then another page is, and my project, yeah, is mainly focused to the elderly who has the very little to the moderate caring needs. Yeah, and due to the performance limitation of bamboo, because it is a natural material, we only can use it for the three-story height building. Yeah, mainly for the modern cities, but with the very stable weather conditions. And yeah, we assume that in certain years later, we will be very confident that it shall gain the approval by the authority. And we also believe that this kind of construction won't be affected too much by the transportation. Thank you. And yeah, we have total 7 objectives: to promote the environmental conservation, to raise the awareness to how to save the world, save the earth. Yeah. And also to try to stress out the needs of the elderly, the living needs. And also they need to stay healthy and stay closer to their environment. I also hope that the designer or the engineers, they will be more responsible, and also they will be more eco-friendly during the design and the construction phases, as well as increase the demand, the supply of the affordable flats to help our needies to have a more reliable flat. And yeah, we try to make the first totally recyclable bamboo MIC unit. We hope to make it real, maybe within 5 years. I also try to use the modular integrated technology and also the building information technology to get more involved into this project, and try to how to combine this kind of technology to bamboo and the natural materials. And finally, it is the small prototype. And now we shall also talk about some benefits of it. And we have total 4 benefits. The first one, we shall talk about the fast growth of bamboo, because at most it takes 15 years to maximum height, and minimum only 4 years. It is a quite desirable duration compared to timber. Yeah, it can also last for 25 years at most. So I would say it's quite feasible and quite realistic. And another one is the lowered construction cost. Yes, because there's the reduction of the on-site labor, and that should not be so complicated working procedures like scaffolding, concreting, as well as saving the huge budget, especially for concreting, like the £200 per day, and the plumber is roughly £150 per day. Another one is the better quality control to have the prefabrication following the manufacturing standards like ISO 9001 quality management and the ISO 14001 environmental management system. Yeah. And the final one is the promotion of the sustainability. We try to enhance the availability of the natural materials to reduce the greenhouse gas and try to reach net zero carbon and net zero waste. Yeah, and these are the different steps of my project. Firstly, you can see it is the literature review, and we try to mix the design in different stage, the initial design, the design development, SPU storing, et cetera. And then we will do the procurement, the delivery, and the fixing. After that, we test the materials in the laboratory, and we also invite different parties to give us some comments and visit our project. And finally, we have also prepared the animation, the prototypes, and promotion. Yeah, and then about the research methodology, I would just simply say in short sentence. Actually, before the launch of this project, both me and my professor had visited Xiaoguan, which is a big city in the Guangdong province, the north part of it. And it has a very special weather, the monsoon-influenced humid subtropical climate. Yeah, this kind of keywords are very important because it is the most suitable weather and the zoning for bamboo to grow in the most ideal case. And then the modeling, yeah, we try to make the prototypes to demonstrate our ideas. And then in the laboratory, we use sensors, we use the compression and tensile machines to test it. We also performed some simulation, try to test it, how it will work using some programs, and finally the interview with some professionals. And then now we will move on to the second part, is the modeling. For the modeling, actually we have performed four of it. Two of it is the they are the architectural models, and another two, they are the structural models. We have one of it is the single threads, another one is the double threads, and all are in 1:10 ratio. You can see it has the 3 meter height, story height, which simulates the real life situation. And then you can have a look at our photos of my craftsmanship. Yeah. The left one and the right one, they are the external view of my prototype. The middle one is the top view. And this one is for the double room, and another one is for the single room. Yeah. And I would also like to take this chance to say a big thanks to the technicians at school, because they teach me a lot how to fix the boat and use some methods to make it stand alive and try to make it more stable. I learned to use how to use the hinges to fix different corners. And I also need to consider maybe somehow the use of the grout may also help. And then I would also like to say that the technicians helped me a lot to cut out the panels from the back panels to different small pieces. And this one, it talks about the structural modeling. And as you can see, I've also made it not just in the workshop, but also at home. And another photo you can have a look is the, yeah, this one should be the single, the left one is the double room. The right one is for the single room. Try to simulate how the structural model perform. Yeah. And you can't see any walls here because the walls act as the non-bearing walls. And then we move to the virtual prototypes. And for this part, I've present a short video for you. And you may have a quick look at it. Hi, Antonia.
Hello. I think I'm not sure whether the video is being shared in the chat box or whether that's being played now. So I will have to confirm that for you.
Is it okay for me to play it?
You can try, yes. I can stop
thank
sharing.
Thank you. Yeah. And I would like to demonstrate a video to you. So sorry. Hold on, just a second. Can you see my screen? Hi.
Yes, we can.
Thank you. I will try to impress you. Firstly, you can see the bamboo floor with the foam, and also you can see the internal walls are built, and then the wall linings like the wall paint and also the we try to
hi, Tony.
To another side of
hi. I don't think we can see your screen.
Can you see my screen now? Sorry.
Yes, Tony, we're back to your presentation now. We just couldn't see your video.
Oh. Okay, is it okay for me to show this video?
I think it didn't work, so maybe we should start with or reconvene with your presentation, if that's okay, Tony. And I'll share my screen again. Let me catch up. Sorry. Here we go.
Yeah. Let's begin with the virtual prototypes. Yeah, the next page. Hi, Antonia. Yeah. Yeah, you can see for this one, it's actually a double room. The left one, it is the showing the facades and the parapet walls on the roof level. And the right one is the session view. You can see it is the bedroom and also a living room. And another page, it is the single room. Yeah. This time you can also have a look at the bathroom. And it also shows the session view of the roof formation. While the coming slide is actually the structural models. Yeah, this one is actually, it is created and it is designed and calculated by Ming. And for this one, actually, it is a single room design. Yeah. And then this page, yeah. Thank you. And then the next session we shall begin with is the testing part. Yeah. Actually, we have some certain items to deal with. Firstly, we try to test the feasibility and the durability of bamboo to see how it works or not. And then we try to find out the pros and cons of bamboo in terms of the physical and mechanical properties. And we also want to add this reference to the future practitioners, as well as having a quick look at the testing data. And right now, we shall begin with some photos we have taken during my experiment. And then the next page, please. Antonia, hello. And then, yeah, actually, we have performed in total should be 10 tests. Two of it is the physical test. They are the moisture and light refraction test. We have the data. The moisture test, moisture content of the bamboo is nearly 7.4%. While the light refractions, the most common one, the light carbonized one, it has nearly 85%. I would say it was quite nice. And then we shall also have a look at the mechanical properties. Next page, please. Yeah. As you can see, we have put the not just the samples, but also equipment of it. The first one, the page before, that was the compression. And this is the tensile test. Yeah. And then the next one, yeah, for both compression and tensile tests, we perform both the parallel and perpendicular tests. And this one, it is the hardness test, and it composed of three parts: the Jenker ball test, the steel ball test, and also the J molding test. So we need to use different fixing heads. And another one, it should be the another test is, that one is the bending test. Yeah, we test both the thickness 7 mm and also 15 mm. And the last one, it should be the shear test. Yeah. This one is the shear test. And we try to test it on the differential settlement position. Yeah. And the below are the summary tables. And I will just simply say the main figure of it. All right. The first one, the compression perpendicular test, we have the compressibility nearly 1%, while the water content is 6.8%. The compression parallel test has the strength around 36 MPa. And another test, when we move to the tensile test, for the tensile perpendicular test, we have the 2.3 MPa. And the parallel one, we have 43 MPa. And I will conclude that the tensile parallel test, the tensile parallel properties was better in bamboo. Now the shear strength in bamboo is 12 MPa. It's not that bad, I say. And after that, we shall move on to the hardness test. For the hardness, we have three testing data. The first one, the maximum load is about 8,000 Newton. And the steel ball test, we have the loading about 1,000 Newton. And the final one is nearly the same, also nearly 1,000 Newton, for J modern. The final summary table shall be the bending test, a list of statistics, but we majorly look at the ultimate strength, the 5 MPa, while the bending for the 15 mm, it should be the next page. It should be 5.6 MPa. I will say that the larger the thickness, the better the bending strength it is. And then next page, please. I will say once again, I will make a great thanks to the laboratory technician, because without their great help, I can't complete the whole long set of the testing equipment, long duration of the experiment. Thank you very much for the great help. And we also invite some external parties to give us the review and audit. For this slide, as you can see, we have invited the CIC, the Construction Industry Council in Hong Kong, and the he shall be the production development branch manager, Mr. Mark, who is also the civil engineer, to give us the review and the visit to our project. We have taken him to the laboratory, and we also present in front of him in our department office with different posters. They were also decided by me. And another page is also another meaningful period. Another page, it is, as you can see, Antonia. I've also joined the different pitchings, like the lab one. It is the Data Tech 2019 to promote the elderly village using the sustainable materials. And the right one, it was actually, it was one of the promotion in the Cullen Park when I was in year three with my professor. When I have a look at my recent achievement, I would say that my most valuable achievement should be attending this Academic Summit 2023 here. Because I have a great chance to share my experience with all of you and also learn from all of you. And another page, we shall also look at our expectation of this project. We have some dreams we hope to reach. Firstly, we try to convince more designers, engineers to be more responsible. And also we try to urge them to be more eco-friendly throughout the design and construction. And we hope to have about 60% of the elderly can enjoy this kind of sustainable construction in the coming 3 or 4 decades. And I also try to produce more journal papers in aid of my professors. Yeah, thank you. And another one, I also need to mention is the hard time. Yeah, there are also some barriers. Before we try to make our dreams come true, we also need to solve some technical issues like the legal problem, the authority problem. When we talk about the building approval, when we talk about the doubts or the some training issues, something like that. And then another page, please. Here are the list of my planned activities, and I hope I will try to make each of them come true. Actually, I've produced some animations video for this project, and I try my best to promote my papers, not just in CIOB, but also maybe in other associations, and some posters, banners, and also we try to engage into different exhibitions. And another page, I would like to once again say a great thanks to all of my teammates. Thank you, my project teammate Ming, Crystal, and David. And also some final year students who helped me a lot in the laboratory, including Anderson, Vision, and Stephen. And I would also like to mention my contract manager, Hasanda. She's very helpful and patient and helped us a lot. Also, we also need to say a great thanks to our department, ACE of City University of Hong Kong. The bamboo supplier, Bamboo International Group Company Limited, and also my supervisors, Professor Lim and Dr. Fong. And finally, say a great thanks to my own family, because they are so willing to accept my very bulky prototypes to occupy the house space. And another page. And last but not least, please have a look at the URL link below, which is prepared for the questionnaire for you guys to ask me more questions. And you can also use the QR code, use your mobile phone to easily scan it out. And please help me to conduct this survey, and I can get more information to improve our research. We may also gather the statistics and publish in the coming papers. Thank you. Thank you, Antonia. And thank you, Joanna.
Thank you, Tony. Thank you from me.
Hi, Antonia.
Can you hear me?
Sorry. Hi, Antonia. Can you hear me? Sorry.
Yes.
Can you hear my voice? Sorry.
Yes, I can. I think we've got a little bit of delay, Tony.
Oh, sorry. I'm so sorry for that.
I just wanted to say thank you for your presentation today. It was a very insightful presentation, a refreshing presentation, and I'm sure it sparked a few questions in a chat box for us. So would you mind if I just read some of those questions for you so that you can answer?
Oh, yeah. No worries. Aside from the Q&A, is it possible for Antonio to help us to play the two video maybe a few minutes later after I answer the questions?
I will consult with my team if we can make that work, Tony. Let me just find out for you. If I now fire some questions, let me catch up with questions.
Is it I choose the question or Antonia read the question?
Yes, I am.
Which one do you prefer?
So we've got one question from Oluwasim, who is asking, what's the project proposing the use of bamboos in construction as frameworks?
I'm not sure the framework that he means, isn't it? He was saying about the structural material.
I think, Tony, they're just asking what's the project proposing, and I guess you've explained that there's a use of bamboo in construction as a material. Is that correct? I think that question has been answered, unless you want to add anything yourself.
Actually, we try to use bamboo to it is more of an ideal sustainable material to make a very eco-friendly house for the elderly. And we try to firstly we target at the elderly needs, and then we can also have a look try to promote further to see maybe it can also be used for the affordable flats in the future.
Thank you. And we also have a question about how feasible is this?
When you are talking about the feasibility, I believe it should be a yes. But it depends on which countries are you looking at. If you are looking at some very strict countries, for example, in the UK, it needs the building facade to be 100% fire rating. It means it needs to have a very strong fire insulation. Then maybe in this kind of countries, we can't make it. But I strongly believe that we can make it in some maybe some developing countries, and also we may also try that in mainland China or in Tokyo or in Hong Kong. And I strongly believe that especially in some Asian countries, we have nearly unlimited supply. And I believe we can be.
Thank you very much. We've got another question here from Ross Thorpe. The land price is so high, Tony. So how will this be affordable?
I'm not sure. Rosaline? I'm not sure what Rosaline is emphasizing. The land price, does she mean the land bidding price, or she is talking about the concession cost? I'm not sure which one is she looking at.
Tony, I'm talking about would you need to buy a piece of land to put this type of structure on, and If you did, it's obviously the piece of land costs a fortune. You showed us the prices were eye-watering. They're different across the world. And I take your point that you could use it in developing nations. I think it would be brilliant. But if you come from a country, a small country, where the land pricing is really high, how do you make this work?
Thank you for question. We may try to make it in some rural areas. For example, in Hong Kong, I understand that some cities like Yunnan, which has a large area of the brownfield area, and there may also be some suburban area. We can also look at it, and I believe the land price there will be largely different compared to those in the maybe in the CBD or in some very busy area. Yeah, I would say.
Okay. There's some more questions and some comments as well for you, Tony. We've got a question from Teddy. How long does bamboo last as building material?
25 years at most.
25 years. Thank you.
25
years. So we've got some comments about bamboo. It's a fast-growing plant, flexible as fibre, good in tropical weather regions and are high-risk earth areas. I suppose you agree with that.
For me, I would say it's hard to tell. It depends on which type of bamboo construction method to adopt. If you are talking about using the one I mentioned in my presentation, using the laminated bamboos to make it like a common flat, the prefabricated flat, then I believe those one may not work well in some area with a high flooding risk. Yeah, I don't think so. Or in some very tropical, very hot and very wet area, maybe it doesn't work well. But in some very cold region or not that close to the tropical, I would say that it should work well, yeah.
We also have a comment here from Andrew. He said hello to you, he appreciates the efforts put into your design to validate the technical specification by the various tests your innovations were subjected to.
Thank you, Andrew. Thank you so much.
There's also some a view on from a guest called MKTS. My view, Hong Kong is not a good area for bamboo building since structure performance of bamboo is difficult to predict. Would you like to comment on that?
I would like to talk to Mr. Tae, about your point of view. I need to emphasize that our project only looks at the superstructure part, not more than three-story heights. And then we also look at the stability, not to carry too heavy loading. And then for some coastal area, maybe near to the Victoria Harbour, I don't think it is that realistic to make it without the waterproofing or without insulation yet. Maybe we need to enhance the weatherproofing performance, the durability, by putting more insulation on it. Yeah. And also the building performance. Yeah, I would like to mention that bamboo has a quite good tensile performance, and it run pretty good, especially in the seismic loads to prevent the earthquake. Yeah.
And I also have a question for yourself, Tony, in terms of would you say, in your opinion, is a bamboo more superior material to other materials? How does it compare or fare to other materials? And actually, that ties in with the question from Teddy as well, who's asking about the future and can bamboo replace timber or steel in the future?
Firstly, I would like to say that bamboo is a very elegant material in the world. It is very powerful. And although it is very thin and tall, but actually it can be very strong. Yeah. It has huge availability and fast growing. And then referring to isn't it? I forgot. Yeah, it is Teddy. Yeah. I believe we can't say it can 100% replace timber or steel, because it is solely a natural material. We can't use it to compare to stainless steel or the normal steelwork. Yeah, for some heavy loading. And if you are talking about, for example, a tall shopping mall or even high-rise building, skyscraper, and even other types of big buildings, like bundles of estates, I don't think that won't work well solely with the bamboo natural material. Yeah. And about the comment by Hasana, yeah.
Yes, so I was just about to read the question out to you. But do you think a growth in bamboo trees production is sustainable in the longer term? Is it environmentally friendly?
Yeah, I do think so. Because when one branch of the bamboo stick it is cut, actually in the root, there are so many hidden branches. And another branch will sprout out to under the ground, and it shall grow up in another nearby position. So I would say that this kind of mechanism makes it very feasible and also available. Yeah.
Okay, well, I think we're sort of nearing the end of session, Tony. Thank you very much for all your efforts. I think we will be able to play some of your videos.
thank you, Antonia.
So if we can, if I can hand over to my colleague Teddy, who will try and share some of the videos for all of us to look at, and hopefully it will work this time for us. So thank you for your time.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you so much. Yeah. For the video, we can choose the top quality of it, yeah. And you can have the setting on the, it should be on the bottom right section. You can select the highest quality. It also has the music, yeah. And Teddy can also turns on the sound to also can hear the music. Yeah. It is my great pleasure to introduce my project to the CIC manager and also to my department head. Yeah, and the last page you can see it. That one is actual my draft, I would say. Yeah, because I try to put the Asian design into my bamboo housing project. Hi, Antonia. I think you need to unmute. Sorry. Yeah, I can hear you.
Sorry, Tony, we're just having a few comments here between us. It looks very beautiful what you've done there, and it's on a small scale. We all want to move in, less tidying up. I believe if this is all the videos you wanted to share with us, and I believe also that might be the end of this presentation session.
Yeah, thank you.
And I would like to now hand over to my colleague, Tabarak.
Thank you so
thank
much.
Thank you
very much
see
for your
later.
Time.
Bye-bye. Thank you.
Hello. Thank you very much, Antonia. Good afternoon, everyone. And again, thank you very much for joining us in this afternoon session. For those of you who have joined in the afternoon session, I'll just give another briefing of this poster part of it. Of course, we are excited to have you with us, and it is an opportunity for all of us to learn from each other and grow together. For those who don't know me, my name is Tabarak Bellal. I am a professor of construction engineering and management at the School of the Built Environment, University of Reading in the UK. And I'm your moderator for this afternoon poster session. So our guests who are presenting the poster are all from the School of the Built Environment, University of New South Wales in Sydney, Australia. They are Cynthia Changxiang Wang, who is a senior lecturer, Risa Yosia Sanindio, who is an associate professor, and Samuel Frimpong, who is a postgraduate researcher in construction management. First of all, I would like to thank the speaker for taking the time to share their knowledge and giving us real life examples. The poster topic is about promoting positive mental health among young construction workers from the Global South. And we're really excited to share what we know with you. And this session will focus on promoting an understanding of positive mental health and how it can be facilitated among young construction workers. We'll also take questions at the end of the session, so please do feel free to type into the chat box. Of course, given the time zone difference, Cynthia and Risa, I don't think can be with us. It's 2 a.m. in Australia. But we do have Samuel, who is going to give the presentation. And without further ado, Samuel, the floor is yours.
Thank you for the introduction, Tabarak. Let me share my screen. Step 1 minute. All right, so as you heard, the emphasis of this topic is on positive mental health. Why are we focusing on this? The special group that we are giving attention to in this case is young construction workers. That's in the context of the global health, those who are 35 years and below. This particular group is special because they are among some of the people with the highest prevalence of poor mental health on the earth. So current statistics from research indicate that this group has a suicide rate of more than 2 times that of the general population in many countries that you can consider. And also mental health conditions such as substance use disorders are very common among this group. And when you compare young construction workers to other young people who work in different types of industries outside the construction industry, you realize that the prevalence of poor mental health conditions is more than twice that of other groups. So it's actually a group of concern. But then a review of the literature shows that anytime we bring up the topic of mental health in the construction industry, most studies will be considering things related to disease, just as the statistics showed. But it's established that mental health is not just a matter of disease. There is also positive aspects of mental health, which actually mean well-being. So instead of we thinking about someone being sick when the topic of mental health comes up, we want to think about how well they are doing mentally. So our studies focus on how this kind of mental health can be promoted. And we give attention to three main questions. What is positive mental health? What are the key mental health risk factors that affect young construction workers? And then what kind of coping mechanisms can potentially result in positive mental health for young construction workers? Now, the background to this is that we have been collecting data for almost 5 years on an ongoing project in Ghana that focuses on using the construction industry as a means to reduce youth unemployment. So we've been following this study for quite some time now. We started by doing a systematic review of the literature, that is, we searched for all the research that has been conducted on mental health in the construction industry. And then we filtered out those that focus specifically on young people in the industry. That left us with only 32 studies. And after we looked at the studies, we found a few factors in relation to mental health risks and also the kind of coping mechanisms employed. You know, as always, most of the research comes from developed countries like Australia and the UK. So we wanted to adapt what we found to the situation of young construction workers in the Global South. And in this case, Ghana was a case study, which is a typical Global South country that shares similar characteristics with other developing countries. So we started by conducting interviews. We interviewed 16 different groups, and some of the participants in the interviews were young people in the construction industry, their employers, their family members and their friends, and then mental health professionals, as well as other government agencies. And then some were even clients of construction companies. After we did the interviews, we set up a focus group to be able to look at, you know, interviews focus on individuals. We wanted to focus on this time how the things that we found look like from a group perspective, because the issue of mental health and then other health factors also have group characteristics. So there were two focus groups, one with a set of experts and the other with a set of young construction workers. And then we put the question to them, what does positive mental health mean to you? What things expose you to poor mental health and good mental health? And then when these things happen, how do you respond, to help us understand the coping mechanisms? Now, let's look at the issue of positive mental health. We found four main aspects. First was emotional health. That basically represents things that are reflective of good feelings. And then we also identify things related to psychological health. These ones are reflective of personal progress. For example, when a young person gets promoted at the workplace, it's and the kind of feelings that this invokes is reflective of psychological health. And then we also looked at social health, a sense of progress in the community or the workplace, and how young people feel they are contributing to the well-being of other people and also to the progress of the society. And then we found other things associated with spirituality, for example, religion, the impact of construction work in connection with how well they are able to participate in religious activities, what they attribute their successes to. So typical examples were young people feeling satisfied that they were pleasing God, feeling satisfied that their work was allowing them to engage in religious practices without restricting their spiritual progress. So all these were now put into one framework, which has four components. That is positive mental health. Now, the difference between what we found and what has been published is that in the published literature, only emotional health, psychological health, and social health are considered as components of a positive sense of well-being or mental health. So our research captured spiritual health as a new component or as an emerging component of positive mental health. And take note that this is within the context of the Global South, that is developing and the middle income countries. Now, the mental health risks that we captured were mainly three. First was personal, second was organizational or industrial factors, and the third was socioeconomic. So starting from the bottom, the socioeconomic factors mainly cover the personal finances of individuals, the kind of opportunities in the industry, the kind of families they come from, family setup, are they having family problems, do they get support from the home, and so on and so forth. So an example of a socioeconomic factor has to deal with the support that a young person is getting, perhaps to learn a trade in construction, or the support that they are getting to pursue some form of training in the university. And then organizational factors deal with nature of work, the work context, as the kind of environment they work with in, and then the industry social cultural norms. The nature of work, for example, deals with is the work hard? Do they need to exert themselves physically or mentally to do these kinds of works? And then work context is, for example, what kind of management practices exist at the workplace? Do they get opportunities to learn about mental health at the workplace? Does their employer sponsor further training? And then industry sociocultural norms are practices that are either openly endorsed or not openly endorsed. For example, how women are treated in the industry. We found out that in most places, women are looked down upon when they want to participate in the industry. The personal factors deal with the personal characteristics. So it could be that they have an existing physical or mental health condition that makes it difficult for them to fully participate in construction work. And then how much knowledge they have about mental health and even professional knowledge. All those were the mental health risk factors. When we move on to coping, we identified that there were several types of coping, but two key types of coping helped them to achieve good well-being. The first was problem-focused and then emotion-focused. The third one that we found did not really correlate well with positive mental health, which was maladaptive coping. Now, when we talk about problem-coping, focused coping, it basically focuses on the strategies that young construction workers use to address a problem at the workplace. So in this case, the emphasis is on the problem itself. An example is active coping. So for example, if they are facing bullying, which makes it difficult for them to have good well-being at the workplace, a type of active coping will be reporting to the supervisor and then ensuring that the supervisor takes steps to address the source of the bullying. That is one. And then an example is also planning. So before they go to work, they can create scenarios in their mind that if this happens, I'm going to respond this way. If someone says this to me, I'm going to respond that way. That is an example of problem-focused coping. And it was found to correlate well with positive mental health. Now, the second group is emotion-focused coping. This time, instead of solving the problem itself, these strategies are adopted to address how young people feel about the problem. So one example is emotional social support seeking. So sometimes all they will do is to talk to a close friend about the situations. And then once they feel that they have a listening ear, then they know that, at least someone cares about them, makes them feel good or assures them that, well, things will get better in the future. And some also turned to religion. So they were praying and then they were seeking counseling from religious leaders. When we put all these together, you can see the model down there. This is the model that we are proposing for trying to understand how positive mental health happens. So first, young people are exposed to a set of risk factors. Depending on the intensity or how these factors play out, they can also become protective factors. It leads to a set of responses, which we term as coping strategies. Depending on how good these strategies are, the outcome can be positive mental health. Now, why is this model important? It's established in the medical profession and then in psychology literature that each individual has two phases of mental health. They are different but related. the more negative mental health you have, the closer you are to becoming mentally ill. But the more positive mental health you have, the closer you are to having mental well-being. So then if we begin to study this particular model further and we identify all the health or protective factors and the type of coping strategies that help young people to realize positive mental health, then it means that we are closer to also developing strategies that can promote their mental well-being. This is a more effective approach to what we are currently doing, which is trying to treat symptoms of mental illness, which alone will not lead us to achieving mental well-being among young people. Now, also, the identification of spiritual health as a component of positive mental health is significant. That's because it shows that it is a part of the things that improve the mental health of people, particularly from the global south, or people who might be religious. That means that at the workplace, when we are planning conditions associated with young people's work, we need to factor in how the work will affect their spiritual well-being. We cannot just look at things related to promotion and workplace contribution and how people feel. We must ask ourselves, do these kind of policies negatively or positively affect how young people are able to participate or achieve spiritual health? Once we add that to the ingredients of positive mental health, we know that we'll be able to improve the mental health of young people further. So in conclusion, I'll emphasize that positive mental health includes social health, spiritual health, emotional health, and then psychological health. And this should be considered further in the measurement of positive mental health. So that means that in future, when we are developing questionnaires or survey instruments to be able to understand how healthy, how truly healthy young people are in terms of their mental health, we have to factor in spiritual health. But then this is just like work in progress, one phase of the work. We will need to conduct further studies, especially quantitative studies on different settings, because the global south is broad. Young people are different. We have wide variations in the population. Even between males and females, there are wide variations in how people respond to these kind of issues that we have identified. So the next stage will be trying to broaden the studies in different fields and also looking for collaborations among those of you here and anyone who is interested. So this is why I just want to end it. And then if you have any questions, I will take them.
Thank you very much, Samuel. Very interesting research. I would like to start off the questioning myself. I posted the question on the chat box, but I think this aspect of spiritual health and the building of positive mental health is quite peculiar and important in the global South. I think you indicated earlier on that it is you haven't found in the literature reference to spiritual health. It's mostly emotional, psychological or social health. So my question is whether you found through your research a response from construction firms and companies and maybe construction contractors, those working either on site or in office, whether they provide the space, physical space, for those who want to practice their kind of religious practices.
So, during the focus groups, we found out from some employers and then young construction workers themselves that there was not a deliberate attempt to provide for spiritual health. So it happens that if you find yourself in an environment where generally the people that you work with understand what your spirituality means, then they can make exceptions for you. For example, if you would have to go to church on Sunday or to go to the mosque on Friday, if your employer understands, fair enough. If they don't understand, then you always turn in between trying to go to wherever you want to go, worship with a particular group or not. Yeah, so sometimes some people mentioned that sometimes they can travel to place because construction involves a lot of traveling, and then for long periods they will not have any form of contact with their religious groups and other activities that makes them satisfy their sense of spirituality, and they think that that is a problem. So actually it was part of our recommendations that employers should begin to consider these things when designing the conditions associated with the work that young people do in the construction industry.
Thank you. Thank you. I have a question from Ross. and her question is really based on the characteristics of the construction industry. So how much are the working conditions, long hours, cold weather? I'm not quite sure in Ghana whether that would be relevant in the global south. and travel away from family and tensions to deliver at pace, to blame for our poor mental health in the industry.
Okay, so basically we see that there's a very strong relationship between the work-related factors and then the coping and then mental health as an outcome. And we are still doing our quantitative modeling, but we see that the main incidence of work conditions is on coping. And the kind of coping that young construction workers choose is what reduces positive mental health, which in turn allows negative mental health conditions to fester. So, for example, the work condition like bullying, it's very significant, and it results in coping mechanisms such as drug use, and then alcohol abuse, and then something like especially in the case of young women, once they realize that the people around them are very hostile, they also try to protect themselves by always venting on their emotions, so being aggressive, just so that the young men there who are harassing them will also feel that the women can fight back. And that is also a type of coping that reduces their emotional health. So basically, every aspect of the industry is an issue that results in negative coping or poor coping, and then that reduces the positive mental health of these young people. The only challenge we have is that the way the industry is set up, it will not require only organizational level changes to be able to address some of these issues. It has to trickle down from the industry level. There has to be a conscious effort, because these are characteristics across board. When you do a literature review, you will see that whether developed or whether a country is developed or not, the industry norms that trigger negative coping are the same across board. And that's perhaps has something to do with the culture of masculinity in the construction industry, which has to be dealt with progressively.
Thank you, Samuel. There's another question, two questions related to each other, actually. One from Ross, and she's asking whether we need to educate the industry on how to spot the signs of poor mental health and what to do. And the other question from Hassana is, how early on should the education on mental health and well-being start?
Okay, so it's good this question is coming at this time. It would have been difficult if the seminar was held last year as planned. So just last week, we have finished our analysis on the impact of education and training on positive mental health. And we considered three things. One, someone's personal education, personal academic education, for example, how much university or high school training they have. And then we also looked at workplace supported education on mental health. And then we looked at voluntary learning on mental health. These were the three types of learning we considered. And we saw that the level of academic education they have is not significantly related to how they respond to mental health. What was significant was, most significant was their personal learning. For example, if someone stayed at home and then they decided to read about mental health on the internet, that resulted in positive coping more than any type of education. So the recommendation that we are putting forward in our future research is that we would have to find a way to get the material out there and encourage young people to learn on their own. Because we saw that even workplace education, which basically deals with employers setting up programs to educate these young people, was not working really well. And although we have not really singled out any particular factor, other studies done in other countries suggest that these young people don't want to entertain formal workplace strategies that are put in place to help them to improve their mental health. They would like to do things on their own, learn from their friends. So it means that we would have to find some way to put the material there, whether they have completed school or yet to start their construction education, or at whatever level they are in their professional career. We can just ensure that the material is out there, and then we find ways to direct them to reach this the available information so they can take it in at their own pace. That will be the most effective.
Okay, thank you very much. I think Ross has a statement. I think it is a comment that the CIOB vision is to improve the quality of life of the users and creators of the built environment. There was much argument about including creators, but it was felt that the quality of the built environment is directly affected by the quality of life of those who created. I've got a question from Antonia, and she's asking, in your experience, what is the main challenge stopping employers paying more attention to mental well-being and recognizing this need amongst their workforce?
Okay, so it's in the broader research of which I have been part also. It basically stems from what we prioritize, what we know, and what we don't know. So one, usually when employers are looking for work, they have a number of components that contribute to the cost of the work. Once there's pressure on them to reduce the cost, it's established that in the Global South, where regulation is not very tight, and then in other countries where regulations can be softened a bit, the first thing that gets sacrificed is health and safety considerations. Because health and safety considerations don't form part of the finished work. So you can always compromise on them to the most acceptable degree, depending on the kind of environment in which you find yourself. And then two, research mainly from Australia suggests that even in places where employers are health and safety conscious, they are always looking at the physical aspects of health and safety. So it's about putting on your helmets and then your vest and then things that have got to do with like tangible health and safety issues. So it was even found out in some studies that when young construction workers feel that they are not mentally healthy, they are less inclined to discuss with their employers and then ask for permission for treatment, as opposed to if they felt a physical problem. So it seems that there's still more learning to be done, and then there has to be an acceptance that mental health issues are critical and not to be given attention to.
Thank you very much, Samuel. That's been very, very helpful. The questions are, I think, done unless anybody has a question that they want to raise. And there is a question that has just come through from Andrew Abiona. And Andrew's asking, what are you doing on awareness of mental health issues, particularly to the micro construction company, where you have to think first of wages, then the conditions of works?
Yes. So part of our work also has to do with looking at interventions available in the workplace. And we identified quite a number. The most effective, as I mentioned, was promoting mental health literacy, but that also has its own challenges. So one of our objectives is to now move into another phase where we'll be able to test a series of interventions based on our findings. That is when we'll be able to conclude that this particular set of approaches to increasing awareness is more effective. At the moment, we are still concentrating on just leaving the information out there, developing promotional materials, and then encouraging young people to go look at it themselves and see how well they can make use of it at the moment.
Okay, great. Thank you very much. I think it's coming up to 3 a.m. Where you are, Samuel. Thank you very much for joining us and for the presentation. It has certainly been very insightful. So I would like now to hand over to Hassana, who will be joined by Ehsan Sagat Furush on the next session. Over to you, Hassana. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Samuel. Thank you very much, Tabarak. That was amazing and very insightful. Thank you. Right. So where has the time gone? I'm here to present and introduce our final speaker of the day. And it's been amazing, actually. So without further ado, I will introduce our final speaker, Associate Professor Ehsan Sagat Furush. Apologies for mispronunciation. He's an Associate Professor and School Coordinator for Postgraduate Affairs in the School of Construction Economics and Management at the University of Witwatersrand in Johannesburg, South Africa, mouthful. In his spare time, he leads as a consultant in construction management consultancy in the application of building information modelling, BIM, as everyone else knows. His career in education spans three decades, including earning his PhD in project management from Queensland University of Technology, Brisbane, Australia, and MSc in Project Management from the University of Putra, Malaysia, in Malaysia, and his Bachelor's Studies in Civil Engineering completed at the University of Tehran in Inner Iran. He's a senior advisor in the area of project integration, ranging from theories to practice, and has collaborated actively in several industry research projects, adopting BIM, integrated project delivery, offsite manufacturing, automation, constructability, operability, and maintainability reviews. I must say, a truly international representative and a very apt contributor to our CIOB's Global Academic Summit today. So without further ado, I'd like to welcome Professor Ehsan Sagat Furush to take up the stage and present his research. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Hassana, for the introduction. And I know that pronouncing my family name is very hard, and even pronouncing the name of my university is also very, very hard as well. So yeah, my name is Ehsan Sagat Furush. So everyone here just call me with my first name. So you can simply call me Ehsan as well. Thanks for a very good presentation. And also I really enjoyed a few presentations that I could see before my presentation. I just hope that mine is also as nice as them as well. I don't know whether I should say good morning or good afternoon, or you know, I really don't know what to say now, because I know that we have audiences from around the world, and now we are at almost 5:30 p.m. or nearly 6 p.m. in South Africa in summertime. I'm sure that on the north side of the earth you are in the winter time. I try to keep my presentation within the given time. I'm expected to talk about the growth of construction management education in Africa and some of the research directions that are currently being undertaken by professionals in the field. So in specific, I'm going to focus on the second part of my presentation on the use of IT for dispute resolution in construction management, specifically in multifaceted infrastructure. And the main reason is that it is actually one of the boundaries of knowledge in the area of construction management and how we are using modeling to improve the way we are managing the projects and we are reducing the disputes at the time of construction and even at post-construction phases. I'm currently coordinating the postgraduate affairs in my school. I'm more than happy to be in touch with either of you if you're interested to expand research collaborations. We are open to do that in various construction management fields that we have in our school. We also have property management as well, so that is another area that I have colleagues who can make collaborations with either of you from anywhere in the world. Africa. Okay, I'm not African. I'm originally from Iran. I've got permanent residency here, but I'm originally from Iran and have traveled different countries. So I've been in Malaysia and Australia, and it's already 6 years that I'm in South Africa. So in either of these countries that I have been, one of the things that has catched my idea and my attention was the fact that there is kind of transformation everywhere in the world. And the political changes that are occurring, especially in the developing countries, is severe, and it is affecting various issues. And when it comes to Africa, and specifically in South Africa, we saw that we had a kind of democratic elections on the year 1994, and this has affected lots of things in the country, and education has been one of those major ones. So if we specifically look at construction management, we see that the degree program in construction management commenced in the year 1963 in the country. However, even if we look at the situation of how construction management is currently being undertaken in the country, we still see that it is still lacking to provide those basic technological supervisory junior management personnel in the relatively short time for the country's short to medium term needs. Apart from teaching in university, I'm also involved in some consultations to coal to liquid and coal to gas types of projects in the country. We are using modelings to prevent disputes that are happening in these projects. And I can clearly see that, the current programs are not really providing that in-depth technological support when it comes to implementing construction management in the country. Various policies are coming into action. I'm also teaching safety and quality management course. I know that safety and quality is being considered a lot in many countries, specifically in developing countries. So there is a kind of upward trend in terms of the number of policies that are being issued in South Africa and in African continent in general. And it shows that the governments are now being aware of how important it is to look after people. So I think the previous presentation was kind of related to this fact that people's well-being should be considered as priority. In many countries. However, we still see that there are still a small number of large public companies in the country that are operating nationally, and some of these are just working, only some of them are operating internationally, and they are particularly in sub-Saharan Africa in recent times. Various deficiencies are there in the African construction industry. So we are still in a situation that we see unfavorable working conditions and procedures in the country. We have insufficient attention to the health and safety, which I mentioned it earlier. The questionable ability to deliver within time and budgeting constraints and to required quality standards is something which is still missing there. So we still need to come up with proper planning and proper implementation of the work in many African countries. And what I see here in South Africa as the first country that I have entered throughout whole African continent, I see that it is still lacking there. And I've been to Northwest South Africa a few years ago, I think it was 2 years ago, and I just noticed that in some projects they're still using simple Excel files to do plannings. And in some projects, and they're still use pen and papers to do all of that, while we are having lots of softwares that we can use them. IT has entered construction industry for many years, and specifically in recent years, we see that we can simply use IT to even reduce the number of claims and the number of disputes that are happening in our projects, which is actually the center of my discussions today in the later slides that I'll take you through. Communication is a big issue. Lots of emails, lots of paper communications that are there among various people who are coming from different disciplines. And you know, these different disciplines, they have different languages, they are working with different softwares. And when it comes to working together, it's a big disaster for them to understand each other. So it is very important for us to come up with a shared language so that this shared language can actually provide these people with a shared environment of understanding each other. And this can prevent lots of those communications that are taking place through emails or papers. We can even use softwares that IT is actually bringing for us in construction industry, and, or better to say, in civil architecture and industrial engineering management courses or areas of research that are actually reducing all those communications by using some software, some specific tools that we have in the softwares, which I'm going to refer to that later through the rest of the slides that I'm going to cover today. So if we want to look at What is that last key in all my discussions in these early four slides? We can see that there's a kind of lack of integration among various disciplines, which is actually resulting in various disputes that are happening in construction industry. So in specific, if we look at construction management, we see that there is a high demand of increased output and productivity in the country. We need higher quality standards and lower prices. There are lots of competitors in the country, in the whole African continent, lots of foreigners who has come to this country. They are competing together. And if we want the African company to compete with them, they need to make sure that they are competing with them in terms of providing better productivity of the service and product, both of them. Unions are demanding for improved working conditions. Contractors have little managerial backgrounds, increasing competition in the construction environment, which I mentioned earlier. And all of that, we see that we're still having little attention to areas that requires integration of project stakeholders. So the major problem areas in construction management, as far as I can see in the country, are the management skills that people have, improper productivity or low productivity of many companies that are working in this area. And the major reason is that they are not using the most up-to-date knowledge that we have in the area. Quality is still low. There are lots of reasons behind that. I don't want to go through details of it because I can come up with a full presentation on it. So I just prefer to refer to the fact that the quality is still low, and lack of business skills, lack of suitable trained staff, and finally, lack of enough investment on construction management area. If you look at the research directions that are currently being undertaken in the African continent and even in the world, which is coming to Africa very fast, not even Africa. I've been attending in a conference in my country, in Iran, in south of Iran last month. And, even when you look at those oil and gas projects that we have the one of the biggest gas sites in the world, the second one in the world in south of Iran. So when you go there, you can still see that those construction management tools that are available, they are being used, but they are not really properly being used by the right people, because a software is a tool. If we don't have the right person to work with it, we are not going to get the best out of it. That's the most important thing. So there are some recent research directions that are being undertaken in construction management area. OSM, offsite manufacturing. You might feel on why offsite manufacturing should be brought here on this slide, about which is about construction management. But this is something which I have seen as one of the best clues to reduce the number of clashes, especially when it comes to management of multifaceted projects. Offsite manufacturing make it very easy for people to work at on site, because you are actually reducing the number of issues that are taking place on construction site by building the items out of construction site and just bringing them to the construction site. There are various barriers and lots of enablers in various countries on how we can run OSM. I don't want to talk about that. I just want everyone to know that OSM is one of those top research areas that if we can run it properly in developing countries, it's going to be a big advantage to them. Sustainability and sustainable project management is also one of those areas that is being considered when it comes to construction management. So we have sustainable human resources. We have using the use of sustainable materials at the time of construction. There are various topics that we can go through when it comes to sustainability and the use of sustainable project management ideas. Artificial neural networks is the other one when it comes to unclear relationships or non-linear variables that exist at the time of managing construction projects, especially when it comes to multifaceted projects. This is going to be one of those top areas that we can be considered as a nice topic for the research. And the use of IT in general, I just decided to bring it as a general topic first before going through BIM and IoT, which are the center of attention in this research, in this presentation. The use of IT has made it much easier for people to understand the project. When there are clashes, who the judge is in the court? Is it a professional in the area of construction management? No. Is he or she a professional necessarily in the area of civil engineering or architectural engineering? No, not definitely. So we are facing with people who are going to judge us, but they are not having that much of background in the area of construction management. So what are the best tools that we can use to make it easy for them to understand all these topics in the area of construction management? Modeling, right? So IT is making it easy for us to bring modeling into action. We had modeling in action for many years in the area of construction industry in general, maybe since 1980 something. But the thing is, so it started from CAD designs. I'm going to show you some of those examples now. But the thing is, since 2002, we have come to a situation that we are using databases. And these databases are going to help us to improve the way we are managing the projects. And it's going to help us to model the projects in a multidimensional model, so that even if someone comes to our industry from other industries, that we can simply show them on why we are right and the other party is wrong. Even there is a judge sitting there who's not really from the area of construction management, he can simply judge on based on the models we are showing them. So the models make it easy for everyone to understand. So I'm only referring to the post-construction phase, or even construction phase, and all those disputes that might take place are in these two phases. However, the best time to use building information modeling is to use at the early planning and design phases, which I'm going to discuss it a little bit later for you. IoT, Internet of Things. Just to make it easier for those of you who might not be familiar with the area of IoT or Internet of Things, the simplest way to explain that is, you know what building information modeling is, right? So you know what 3D models are. As soon as you can make these 3D models live so that they are sensitive to some signals that are being sent to this model, it means you have already run IoT in your system. So this is a very simple way of explaining it. A very good example of that is, for example, traffic lights. If they're not working, how can you pick it up that they're not working? Should you wait for people to call you, or no? You can simply put an RFID sticker, which is a kind of electrical sticker. Just put it there on that traffic light. As soon as it stops working, you just get a signal from it in your database saying that traffic light in that crossroad is not working. Attend to it quickly, because it's a jam time, so it's going to be a bad traffic jam there. So you need to attend to that quickly. You can even track on who has attended to it by using the database that building information modeling is providing to you. As you see, all of these knowledge areas are helping to reduce the disputes among various project stakeholders. The construction claims are causing lots of delays in the construction phase and even at the post-construction phase. It's going to have a lot of negative financial outcomes to our projects, and as a result, it's going to increase the complexity of construction work. So to combat all these problems, the courts are moving closer to e-disclosure, meaning that we are using screens, we are using models, we are using multidimensional models, we are using the databases that are using models to improve the way they are showing problems to people, to the judges, to the courts, to actually make sure that, I don't know, the other disciplines, the other contractors, I prefer not to say contractors, the other project stakeholders are not really misusing those dark points that we have in our project. So to shed light on it, we can use these multidimensional models. So technological opportunities are there. We are trying to come up with a kind of a centralized electronic hub. And in the event of claim, or in case of any disputes that might be raised by either of the project stakeholders, we can simply take all those project information from those projects and just present them in form of the models. It's not only about dispute resolution. Even when it comes to disasters, when it comes to attacks, when it comes to a situation that your building is under fire or your factory is under fire, when it comes to reacting to all those things at the time of post-construction, how can you react to them quickly? If you don't have access to that multidimensional model, you're not going to be successful in that. This area of knowledge, which is also very famous in the area of construction management, and it's right at the border of research in the area of construction management, is called as forensic modeling or forensic animation. So we are using modeling as a tool so that we act as a kind of detector, a detective in the project or in that specific case we have come up with, in that claim case or in that dispute case, so that we can start visualizing and orientating the construction site. We can animate the construction activities and their impact on the projects. We can make the scenarios, and on that scenarios, for each of either of those scenarios, we can come up with a model, with an animational model, so that we can simply show why it is important to look at this situation, and we can simply find out who has caused that delay or who has caused those extra costs or issues in our projects in that specific scenario that we have already decided to work on. So I prefer to read this slide from word by word, because that is important and that is the key for the rest of my slides today. Through BIM forensic analysis, we adhere to the principle that a good forensic engineering expert is a detective. Moreover, one who patiently searches for evidence and reconstructs events. The use of IT in construction industry, as I mentioned earlier, has quite a long story. We started from 2D drawings. For those of you who are, I'm sure most of you are coming from construction industry, so you know that we started from the 2D drawings, and all these 2D drawings were on the files, but they were not really web-based. We were still using document-based models. And you know, when it comes to 2D drawings, later AutoCAD just could only increase the dimensions to 3 dimensions, right? And if we only look at 2D drawings like this one, look at this piling. This is an example of piling, which is a simple 2D drawing. If I ask you how the site activities can be planned on this site, or where can we put the devices, or where can we put the equipments on this site, or if there is any rubbishes, where should we put it on this site? You cannot definitely come up with a good answer to these statements, right? Why? Because I've not really given you a good view of the project. You're just simply seeing the activities or the steps of piling for this specific project. So the work procedure is shown very well, but it's not really effective to assess and plan the site activities and processes. Now, when we go through virtual reality modeling, we can see the construction site in a kind of multidimensional model. So it helps us to understand the model, to understand activities, to come up with proper sequencing of the processes. We can even think of how the site condition is looking like. And especially when it comes to working with contractors, imagine we are working with contractors that even some of them are not really professional in working with different softwares. And if you can show them the site through multidimensional models, they can simply find out where they should put their devices, how they should deal with other people who are working on construction site. They can even decide about the accessibility of site. And also, they can decide on where to put every single item that they might have and they might need for their works. In brief, there are lots of benefits that we can get out of it. It will be possible to plan and array the equipment or manpower in the right place timely as per the schedule. It can help us to anticipate how well the execution plan can be applied for some of the issues that are related to construction site activities. It helps us to reduce and minimize the equipment idle times, and it also helps us to prevent the possible accidents that might take place on construction site. In brief, I think the last bullet point, which is here, is the most important one. It prevents fragmented teams. We are in a situation that the technology is bringing lots of new devices and equipment for us. But when it comes to working together, we are living in different worlds. We have people who are working from different disciplines. They have their own languages. When I say languages, I mean they are coming from different disciplines, so they have their own computer, the way they communicate together is different. Like contractors, imagine, let's compare contractors and designers, or consultants, or architects. Even when you come to consultant teams, you can see that even the way those contractors are dealing with each other is different. Even the softwares they are using are different. Imagine a map designer, or an architectural designer, or a structural designer. So those fragmented teams is causing various issues, which we need to prevent that. Why? Because most of the big multifaceted projects are being owned by the government. And who's going to pay for the operation and maintenance? Government. It means that the pocket is the same pocket. Most of these projects are being built by the project owners. And the result of being affected by all those highly fragmented teams at the time of construction is going to be a big number. The poor use of data coupled with highly fragmented teams cost the United States capital facilities industry $15.8 billion annually. And how much of that weight is on the shoulders of the owner? 2 out of 3. So it means that it is very important to make sure that we are planning properly, we are modeling our projects properly, and we are showing it to all existing contractors or all the 16 project planners and all project stakeholders as early as possible during the planning and design phases, so that when it comes to construction and post-construction phases, we have the least number of disputes that might take place. So the projects, the current study shows that over 60% of the major capital programs are failing to meet cost and schedule targets, and 30% of construction cost is rework. The time has really passed, and I'm sure, I think none of us really remember such an image. Look at these two guys who are doing the design on a big paper. Imagine how long this project was expected to work, maybe 50, 60 years. So what happens to this paper? For 60 years, it's not really going to stay there, right? And how many dimensions can they go through? Only 2 dimensions. And when it comes to modifications, it's going to be very hard and very complicated. So it's a very slow process of design. Various mistakes might take place there. It's very hard to control it and hard to make changes into it. Building information modeling is making it easier for everyone to understand how to work with it, to look at projects from various dimensions. So building information modeling was brought into industry by Autodesk. It's really one of those area of topics which is at the boundary of knowledge in the area of construction management. It has been brought to Italy, has also put their names on it, which is virtual building and integrated project model. But it really doesn't matter on what we call it. I think building information modeling is the most famous one because Autodesk softwares are actually the most famous one and the most user-friendly, or maybe better to say, one of they're being practiced and used more compared to the other companies in the area. So, and that's why BIM or BIM is being famous on this thing. The US National Building Information Model Standard Project Committee has defined it as this definition. Again, I prefer to read it from this statement word by word, and I want you please to pay attention to the red words that I have highlighted there. Building information modeling is a digital representation of physical and functional characteristics of a facility. BIM is a shared knowledge resource. It's not only a model. It's not a drawing. It's a shared knowledge resource. So it's kind of a database for information about a facility, forming a reliable basis for decisions during its life cycle. So we are not only about designing something at the early planning and design for the construction phase. No, we are talking about life cycle, and we want all the designs that we are making and all the edits that we are making at the time of building information modeling implementation in the early planning and design phases to be implemented throughout whole project life cycle until the day we want to demolish this building or this construction structure. So it is designed, so defined as early existing from earliest conception to demolition, right? So it's a kind of transition from manual drawings to graphic CAD systems, object-oriented CAD systems, and also finally we have come up with building information modeling. So building informations are saved in form of digital data. However, when it comes to CAD systems, the graphic abstractions of intended building designs are just being shown. So in CAD system, we are just going through 3 dimensions, but when it comes to building information modeling, we are going in step ahead, and we are working with an intelligent model, which is actually a multidimensional model. So I really do not want to go through either of these steps and either of these dimensions, but it might be useful just to say that when it comes to 3 dimensions, we all know what those 3 dimensions are, right? But when it comes to 4th dimension, the question is, okay, what do you mean by 4D? Okay, well, I understand what the 3D is, but what does it mean by 4D? The 4D is when you add time into it. I mean, when you start animating this 3D structure and show people how each of these items are being constructed right after each other. So it means that you have already added your MS project or Primavera file, which is a kind of a Gantt chart that you already have in your hand. As soon as you add it on your structure. So it's going to be kind of scheduling. So you're going to show the scheduling on through an animation. The same with costing. So if you can show the costing, the cost curve, while you are presenting the animation, it means that you have already gone through the fifth dimension, which is cost. The sixth one is the sustainability, and last one is facility management. Honestly speaking, the 5D has been practiced a lot in many countries. However, sustainability and facility management has been practiced less. So if you want to look at doing some researches in the area of building information modeling, maybe 60 and 70 might be better dimensions to go through, because they have been practiced much less compared to the other dimensions. Building information modeling is doing clash detection. Imagine that the design is there, you have the architectural, structural, and map designs in your hand, and the question is, are they clashing with each other or not? Guys, when we are talking in the global village, it means that if there is a construction somewhere in the world, each of those project stakeholders might be coming from different countries even. So they are not seeing even each other while you're doing the design process. So the clashes is highly possible to take place there. So how can we find clashes without using the softwares? It's going to be hard, right? Even without Beam, how could we find those clashes? Yes, we have Autodesk Revit, which can simply do the 3D dimensions for us. It can even run animations for us, but does it give us the clashes automatically? No. If we go through building information modeling, we have some softwares which find those clashes for us automatically, and Navisworks software is one of them. By the use of Navisworks software, we can find these clashes by doing a single click on our software. It does it for us in few seconds. When I say few seconds, it's going to be 3-4 seconds. For those of you who have never worked with Navisworks, try it. It's a very user-friendly software. Honestly, I learned it through manuals. I never attended any workshop myself, but I'm now using it both as a teaching tool, and also I'm using it as in my work, in my practical work in South Africa, and even back in my country. We have even done some projects for Australia as well, with some of my colleagues who are in University of Southern Queensland. So it helps us to analyze the project better. It helps us to come up with better time estimation, better cost estimation. So in general, when we compare Beam versus CAD, we see that in Beam, we are doing building information being stored in form of database. But when it comes to CAD, we are just doing building information being stored in form of formats or drawings. In building information modeling, architects are working on the building information through the drawings. But when it comes to CAD designs, we are directly working on the drawings. And so this is a major difference that exists between these two. There are various studies around the world that has worked on building information modeling and its benefits. Lots of benefits has been highlighted by different studies: reduced documents error emissions, reduced reworks, reduced construction costs, reduced project durations, and fewer claims, which is actually the center of attention in this study, is going to be caused by that. Why? Because we are letting all project stakeholders to see the project and to feel it before the project is really being built. So that is important. So in building information modeling, you are building the project before the project is really being built. It's a very complicated statement. So the clashes are there. We have two types of clashes in projects. One of them is very easy. Imagine a pipe is clashing with a beam, or is clashing with, I don't know, a duct, like this image that you see here. So it's very easy to understand it. So it's called as hard clash. But we have some sorts of soft clashes as well. What does it mean by soft clash? Imagine that you are working in a multifaceted high-rise building. It's a hospital project. And you invite your chiller installer to come on construction site and install the chillers on the 10th floor or 15th floor. And suddenly you hear these guys calling you and saying, hey, you know, you have not still provided us access to that level. And if you want to go to level 15, we cannot go up such, you know, unprepared stairs here. And so please, you know, you should call back us later. However, there's a contract. Based on this contract, you are going to be delayed until you can prepare that environment for us. So it's going to be a kind of soft clash. What does it mean? It means that your project planner has not provided you with proper planning for that earlier stages. so that you actually those people didn't really think of providing proper accessibility of those chiller installers when it comes to the time of installing those chillers. So the tasks given in the list of activities for that week, which was including those tasks, those chiller installers to come on construction site, was actually wrong. So it's a kind of prerequisites and postrequisites of activities. How can we provide that? Of course, we have some specific softwares in the area of project management, like Primavera or P6, Microsoft Projects or MSP, that are helping us with easier preparation of the work breakdown, the structure, and easier planning of the activities. But it's not still enough. Why? Because we still see lots of these soft and hard clashes at the time of operation and at the time of construction. And this is actually causing a lot of costs to people because lots of claims are coming up out of it. Building information modeling is actually helping various softwares. It is actually using various softwares to help us with better planning in our projects. Is building information modeling a software? No. BIM is not a software. So we are not expected to say BIM software. No, it's not a software. But we are having various softwares in the area of construction simulation, MEP or mechanical electrical piping, structure, and architecture that we can use them. Of course, again, Autodesk Revit is one of the most famous ones that we all know. However, Autodesk Navi's work, which is given to the industry during the past few years, is not still well known in many countries, especially when it comes to African continents. So it's highly recommended to use that. I think I came to South Africa almost 6 years ago. When I came here, when I entered industry, I could not hear anyone talking about building information modeling and use of Navi's work in industry. I'm talking about industry. I'm not talking about university. In university, we're always a few steps ahead. We are doing researches on different areas, even in building information modeling. But when I entered the industry, I just felt that it has been rarely used, or even I think it was not really being used in the industry. Yes, we had some companies that they were doing three-dimensional modeling, but they were calling the same thing as BIM, but it was not really BIM. This is an example from University of Auckland, undergraduate laboratories. This is a statement which is really nice. Let's have a look on it. The complicated nature of this project plus a tight time frame required intensive collaboration between the project partners and client. BIM was hugely beneficial in this regard. In this project specifically, they decided to use BIM for pre-design, design, construction. We can use BIM for operation as well, but in this project specifically, as you see on this circle on the right side of the screen, it has been used for pre-design, design, and construction phases. They use BIM for design authoring, design review, engineering, sustainability, and 3D coordination. I also would like to show you some of the examples of what we did in South Africa as well. As you see, this is a multifaceted piping project. I prefer not to name the project and tell you what that project is all about, but this project had multifaceted piping pipings in it, and as you see, by doing the modeling, we could simply even find some elements that they were not really expected to be there, but they had actually bought all these elements. They are very expensive elements, like the valves or some electric devices that you're using to open and close the valves at the time of emergency. So they are very expensive. They bought them, and when the construction was finished and the project was at the handover stage, they just saw that, hey, look, lots of unused items are there on the construction site. So why did we order all these things? And, you know, by doing these modelings, we just figure out that all these items were wrongly detected and designed. And also, apart from that, there were various clashes between the project owner and project contractor in terms of delays that they had caused in these projects. By doing the multidimensional modeling on this system, on this project, we could simply figure out who has caused these problems. And, you know, even in some cases, in few cases, we went through the courts, but after they figured out that we are using building information modeling and a multidimensional modeling tool to prove our statements, they even stopped going through the courts and they just said, okay, enough is enough. So we already know what's happening here. So let's come up with a deal. So it was something that we came up with in a real project here in South Africa, and it was a very nice experience for us as a project consultant who was working directly with the project owner. In this case, specifically when it comes to project disputes and when it comes to construction claims, you're actually using beam as a kind of gun to kill the other party. But it's not really expected to be like that. We are not really expected to use beam as a gun. You know, you're not really use it as a missile to attack the other party. Building information modeling is a tool that is expected to build the project for us before it is really being built, from the earliest conception to demolition. So this is the expectation that we have from building information modeling as one of those recent topics that is being at the border of research, at the boundary of research in the area of construction management. But you know, when it comes to many third world countries, it's not really being used for that purpose. This is the transition. This is the transformation that I was talking to you about in the first slide that I started my presentation. The first highlighted word in whole this presentation was transformation. So I would like to repeat that word again. Many countries, especially the countries that are still developing, they are in a kind of transformation phase. They are in a kind of, they are like in a phase that they are changing. They are changing from an old system to a new system. So when you are in that situation, as soon as a new technology comes in, people do not necessarily know on how best to make use of them. To make use of those technology. Remember, I'm sure all of you should remember the date that we didn't really have mobile phones in hand. I completely remember the first day that my dad bought the first mobile phone in my country. Actually, my uncle was one of those first people who got to bought it in my country. He's a rich guy. So I remember those big phones that just came in. But what happened right after that? You know, as soon as those mobile phones just entered the country and many people started using it, what happened? As soon as those smartphones came in, what happened? What misuses were there in the use of those smartphones? And now what is happening? How we are best using it? When it comes to building information modeling, we are using building BIM 360 as one of the applications in our mobile phones, which is going to help us a lot to improve the way we are doing the work in construction management. And you see how this transformation is happening. So in terms of the use of, in terms of implementing BIM in the African continent, I strongly believe that Africa is in the transition. It's a very good time to enter. For all African students, I always talk with all my students in South Africa, and I always tell them that this is the boundary of knowledge here in the country. Try to catch it. It's not only going to help you to find job here in South Africa, it's going to even help you to find job overseas. Have a look on your LinkedIns. If you have LinkedIn, you can simply search for BIM engineer and see how many people in the world are introducing themselves as BIM engineer. It shows that how beneficial this industry is and how important it is to look at it and how interesting it is to use it for developing countries to make them develop much quicker. That's all from my side for the presentation today. I have finished this presentation quite on time, or maybe a few minutes earlier, I hope. I'll be really glad to be in touch with all of you. It's going to be really hard for me to add all of you, but I'm sure you have my first name and family name now in your hand, so you can simply search me on LinkedIn, and please add me on LinkedIn. I have my own personal website as well, sagatfurush.com, so you can simply search that as well, and all my CV is there as well. So I'm more than happy to be in touch with either of you for shared projects in any fields from any country. I'm currently doing various researches with different researchers from Middle East, from Australia, from West, from United States, from UK, and I think my publications show that. If you go there, you can see all these people are coming from different countries, so we can really work on that. So please email me if you are interested to work on the topics that I discussed today. Thank you again, CIOB, for providing me the chance to present today. Thank you so much.